Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming. We appreciate the support, and we are very excited to be back here in Houston. Just a few points I got to hit. Tickets are on sale this Friday here at the Toyota Center box office. And also, when we come down here, the UFC Fan Expo will be here, and it's October 7th and 8th at the George Brown Convention Center. Many of you have been sitting here watching the video on the fights, on the trilogy, and the other title fight that are coming up, so I'm sure you're all informed on what's going on and who these guys are. So let's open this thing up for questions.
Just put your hand up, folks, and that'll get you the microphone.
Put your hands up and they'll give you a mic. No questions, it's over?
Good one.
Thanks for coming.
Right over here.
For Frankie and Gray, whoever wants to go first, we don't want to duke this out right now. But who do you think's most motivated between you two for this upcoming fight?
Me. No. I don't know. You know, I'm sure we're both highly motivated coming off a draw. You know, we both want this bad, so I believe we're going to bring it on October 8th.
Yeah, probably since January 1st, you know, it's been on my mind every day, every night. And, you know, I just can't wait for October 8th. You know, I want to train hard. I want that day to come, and it's going to be fun. I'm going to come out with the belt.
How you doing? Adrian with Undefeated TV. Question is for Aldo and Kenny. Kenny, you cut a lot of weight to get down to the weight class that you're in to fight Aldo. You look very strong on your last fight. What are your preparations for this one? Is it the same? And what are you expecting Josie Aldo to bring? And Josie, your last fight looked spectacular in the fifth round. Looked like you got a little gas. What do you planning to do on your next one? A lot of Brazilian fighters, when they come off a show and they're not so happy, when they come back and they look spectacular.
You know, it was a lot harder for the last time out just because I was coming off an injury. I wasn't able to work out for 2 months, and you know, when you're not doing anything for 2 months, literally, you know, leg up on the couch for 2 months, can't do anything, you're going to gain weight, and that's why it was especially difficult. But you know, now it's a completely different story. I'm at a far, far lower weight, and I expect the weight cut to be that much easier. And with that said, I still felt that I performed very well. I could have done another five rounds that night. I still felt good. And, I'll definitely be at my best for October 8th. I can't wait.
Júnior, ele falou que você na última luta estava espetacular, mas no quinto round ele achou que você sentiu um pouco um gás. Você acha que você vai voltar por cima ainda melhor como muitos brasileiros fazem?
Com certeza, eu sempre preparo para isso, eu estou preparando para isso, para voltar muito melhor do que eu fiz. Eu acho que muitas pessoas questionaram o quinto round pelo fato de eu estar cansado, mas sim, vai diminuir a luta, porque eu estava jogando com o regulamento debaixo do braço, mas toda vez que eu estiver lá dentro, eu sempre vou dar o meu melhor, sempre vou para cima, sempre vou procurar, sempre dar um show para os fãs.
I'm definitely working on that right now in camp to come back stronger than ever. A lot of people questioned that fifth round. They thought that I gassed and I wasn't in the fight anymore, but I guarantee you that I was still in the fight and I'll come back stronger than ever.
Hey, Kenny, talk about your unique perspective as a member of the fighting community and the media community now, and how you balance the two.
Anytime I have an opportunity to do something involve the sport, I love the sport. So I had a unique opportunity to do some stuff for ESPN and do commentary for the UFC, and I really enjoy doing that. You know, but training and fighting has always been my number one priority. And if that doesn't get done, then I don't do the other things. And I think I found a good balance as far as taking time away from that. And you know, when it's time to train for a fight, I do that. And even, you know, when it's time to analyze fights, I analyze fights. And when it's time to fight, I just fight and kind of leave that up to my coaches to do the analysis and all those things. And I just focus on training. And that's what I'm doing right now at this point. It's just about getting ready for this fight.
Kenny, ¿qué es lo que más anticipas de esta pelea? ¿Qué es lo que más está motivando de este combate que vas a tener?
Bueno, es una oportunidad de pelear por el título contra uno de los mejores peleadores del mundo y yo creo que va a ser una pelea muy difícil, pero estoy listo, es mi tiempo para ganar, estoy entrenando duro y yo creo que el 8 de octubre voy a ser campeón.
Adam Villarreal with Takedown Fight Media. Dana, let me ask you, with Chael being so vocal about, you know, talking about the Brazilians and whatnot, I was curious, why did you guys choose to not have his first fight back against a Brazilian?
I don't know, we don't really, I mean, Chael talks about everybody. I mean, if we want to line him up with everybody that he's talked stuff about, we'd, you know, be tough to do. But, you know,
should UFC Rio or anything.
What's that?
Or for the podcast.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what he has to say about Brian Stan. Yeah. That it's all a lie. He isn't really a war hero. And he's, it'll be interesting. But should he win this fight, we'll be back in there with a Brazilian soon enough if he wins his fight too. So we'll see what happens.
Thank you.
Greg, how you doing, man? Welcome to Houston.
Hey, awesome to be here. Pumped about it.
Great, man. The last fight was spectacular. The last time the UFC was here in Houston, put on a spectacular show. Matter of fact, Roger went to that fight. Was amazing. Y'all's last fight was awesome. What are you looking to bring to this fight that might be different? And Frankie, what are you looking to bring to the fight? Are y'all looking for a finish or a submission? Obviously, you don't want it to go to the judges, so is there anything different? This is y'all's third time around.
Yeah, we've danced a couple times, I guess. But in round one, I think it took it out of me and him. So we fought the last part, you know, about half and half, you know. So I think for the third fight, we're gonna be 100%, and you know, it's pretty much up to him. You know, if it goes five rounds or if it ends early, but I'm going away with the belt. You know, that's up to him on if he wants a whole fight or not.
I don't want a whole fight. So. Now, you know, I mean, sure, we've been in there two times already. Really not many secrets. You know, we've seen each other have. And I, you know, I'm preparing for it. And, yeah, of course I want to finish, you know. I don't want to have that feeling again of going to a draw. So that's what I'm working for.
Dana, one more quick question. Melvin Gillard used to live here, spent a lot of time here training in Houston. When and if he gets past Lozon, when can we expect Melvin to, you know, get that title contention?
Yeah, we were talking about that the other day after the fight with Henderson. You know, there's so many good guys in that 55-pound division. We're trying to figure out who's next. It's that thing is that division's so stacked, and there's so many great fights to make. And I like Melvin, and I like how he's taking this serious now and is training hard. I always thought he was the biggest waste of talent, and he really turned that around. I'm happy to see it. So I'm excited to see him. And you know, he beats Lozon. It's going to be interesting to see who we end up pitting together to fight for the title next.
Thank you.
My question is for Kenny. I'm Barry with thecagedoor.net. When you dropped to this current weight that you're at, did you anticipate getting a title shot so quickly?
You know, I always try to just focus on the task ahead of me, and that was first fight in a top featherweight in Diego Nunez, you know. You know, I knew that would put me in a good position to be one of the top guys. You know, you beat a top guy, you prove yourself as a top guy, and that's all really I was focusing on was beating him. And of course, you know, that's what every fighter's in here to do is fight for the title, and I'm glad that I have that opportunity.
Right back here, the gentleman. Sorry.
Dana, thanks for bringing the fight to Houston, Texas. We're excited. I know the guys are looking forward to fighting here, but I got to ask you a question. How much do you love Twitter?
How much do I love Twitter?
Yes.
I love Twitter, man. I think it's the greatest marketing tool in the history of the world. And it's also a way to, you know, to talk directly to the fans. One of the other things that it does for our business, for instance, you know, people, I always see online people talking about, guy's got the best seats in the house and he's always on his phone. You know, I'm looking at Twitter for lots of different things. People sometimes have problems with their tickets that they talk about on Twitter. Sometimes cable goes out in Indiana or somewhere. I can literally fix things that are happening with the business that night as it's happening. So, Usually you don't hear about this stuff till Monday back in the old days. And you're like, we got to make sure that never happens again. Well, through Twitter, I can fix it that night. There's so many things that I love about Twitter.
Well, I tweeted you, and that's why I'm in the front row today. So thanks for the
pleasure.
Thanks.
You guys better get on Twitter.
Hey, David. Tab referred to just the success UFC has had and talked about how much it's grown since the last time we've been in town. Not just Twitter, but how do you account for that? Was it the pay-per-view successes, just your marketing? I mean, could you just put that in words, how it's grown? I mean, we've got fans lined up here. They've been here for 2 hours waiting for this.
I didn't see the fans back there, you guys. I think it's been a combination of, first and foremost, when we bought this company, we believed in this sport, and we believed in the athletes. And we're on a streak right now of like 6 or 7 fights that have just been amazing, all the last 6 or 7 cards we put on. And basically what it comes down to, this sport is very exciting. And my philosophy has always been, and I can throw all kinds of stats and numbers and all kinds of proof at you and how much the business has grown and everything else, but as far as the sport itself goes, I believe in that right here in this country, there's nothing bigger than the NFL. NFL's huge, right? Most people that don't even watch a game all season, everybody watches the Super Bowl. These guys have been spending billions of dollars to try to break into these other countries. Can't do it. You know, people in England don't care about football. They didn't grow up playing it. They don't understand the rules, and they're definitely not invested in the teams. It's like saying cricket's going to be big here someday, right? But put two guys in an octagon, they can use any martial art they want. I think it crosses all. I don't care what country you come from, what color you are, or what language you speak. We're all human beings. Fighting's in our DNA. We get it and we like it. And like I said, I got all kinds of stats and stuff that I can throw at you. I have no idea if this one's true, but this is what I truly believe, and this is basically what the UFC was built on. Before a guy hit a ball over a wall or a guy threw a ball through a circle, two men were put on this earth. Somebody threw a punch, and whoever was standing around ran over and watched it. Okay? First sport ever created, and it'll be the last sport on earth. So we always believed in the philosophy that it works, and we also believed in the type of people that these guys are, and they prove it every time they go in there. These guys put on great fights, and we felt that there was always a void there, too. I'm a huge boxing fan, grew up a boxing fan. Boxing became this thing where two multimillionaires were stepping into the ring and did everything they could to avoid a fight. And boxing started to get boring to people. And I started to notice, actually, Arturo Gatti. You guys remember Arturo Gatti, right?
Yes.
Arturo Gatti was this guy who didn't have the world title, didn't have this, yet kept signing new HBO deals. HBO kept signing Arturo Gatti because the guy was exciting. People want to see exciting fights. And that's what we deliver. Sorry, that was so long-winded.
No, that was
it got me crazy there.
Well, so obviously, did you think, wait a minute, we're going to have to overcome boxing in order to make this a success?
No. I came from boxing, and I knew that all the problems that there were with boxing. We basically built this company that all the things that we thought boxing did wrong. And boxing and the UFC can coexist. I don't hate boxing. I'm not saying bad things about boxing. I'm a boxing fan. But, you know, they have a lot of problems that need to be fixed and probably won't be anytime soon.
And the other thing, Dan, is how do you, you know, the perception is you don't have a lot of politics going on. You get the best fighters to get together as opposed to the boxing politics. Can you address that?
Well, that's the other thing that I feel that my job is. My job is to put on fights that people want to see. You know, the best example is this Floyd Mayweather and Manny Pacquiao fight. Mayweather refuses to take this fight, won't fight Manny Pacquiao, and it's the fight that everybody wants to see. I want to see that fight. I mean, come on, let's be honest. And I think if you're a fan of mixed martial arts, my job is to go out and put on the fights that people want to see, even if I don't necessarily 100% agree. For instance, I mean, most of you mainstream guys probably don't know the stuff that went on with a guy named Fedor from Russia, but I went after this guy, you know. Even though I said I don't think he's the best in the world, I went after him because the fans wanted to see him. That's what my job is.
With regards to the Fan Expo coming up, can we expect any Hall of Fame inductions to take place?
Yeah, we always do a Hall of Fame induction, Adam. I don't know if we're at that time of the year, but it could possibly happen. I don't know.
Any names you want to...
No clue yet.
This won't go on the internet.
I've been so busy. Yeah. I've been so busy. I haven't really focused on what we're going to do yet. But yeah.
Hey Dana, over the last 5 or 6 years, it seems as though from a matchmaker standpoint, you guys have really done a good job of making sure the matches were made properly in terms of action. Can you talk about styles make fights and how you guys have come about the matchmaking process so there's more action?
Yeah, I agree. Styles do make fights, and not just styles. But the fighters too, the type of fighters and guys who have that fighting mentality, and that's what these guys have. All these guys are hungry. And here's the thing. Here we go. It sounds like I'm going to be crapping on boxing again, but I'm not. You know, these guys, boxing had that same old story, man. I came from the mean streets of such and such. If it wasn't for boxing, I'd be dead or in jail. That was every guy's story. It's not the case with these guys. These guys are all intelligent guys. Most of these guys went to college. And these guys could be doing anything they wanted to do. This is what they choose to do because they love it. They're passionate about it. They're into it. And when you get guys like this, you get great fights. You know, I don't ever really have to sell these guys too hard on getting out there and fighting. It's all about these guys. It's all about the fighters.
Rosemary
Clark
with Undefeated Magazine. What's next for the UFC? What goals and accomplishments that can we see that, you know,
that
has not been met so far?
Well, next week I'm flying to Brazil. We're putting on our first fight since we've owned the company in Rio. And it's amazing how fast this has grown in Rio. It's exploded. Their economy is exploding. And just to give you an idea, and, you know, in this economy and in this market and as much as we've been doing business all over the world, you know, there's some places that we knew when we went into Toronto for the first time that it was going to be huge. You know, we broke every record there. We sold 55,000 tickets, and this was a few months ago, and it was amazing. We felt Brazil could be big. We just didn't know how big. So we end up getting a 14,000-seat arena, right? The day the tickets went on sale, 350,000 people were online looking for tickets. So we probably could have done a soccer stadium. So I'm kicking myself in the ass a little bit there, but, you know, I don't know. It's going to be big in Brazil. We're focusing on Brazil right now. We're flying down there. We're going to fly up to all the different cities, and we're meeting with mayors and politicians, and we're talking about moving this thing all over that country. We're talking about Korea, Japan, India, China. So we're going to continue to open up these new markets. Like I said earlier, you know, this thing works everywhere. People get it, and people like it.
Adrian with Undefeated again. This is for, speaking of Brazil, the UFC's got two, without a shadow of a doubt, the best pound-for-pound fighters in the world are from Brazil, Anderson Silva and Jose Aldo. Jose, what are you looking to do this fight? Kenny Florian's got a ton of experience. He's coming down to take your title. What are you looking to do differently? What are you looking at? Are you looking to make an example, to make a showing, and be Jose Aldo pound-for-pound king?
Ele falou que você, como Anderson, um dos pound for pound melhores, e o que você quer provar nessa luta? O que você quer fazer de diferente para se posicionar como um dos melhores realmente?
Ah, Anderson, sou eu e eu acho que é o meu trabalho. Eu acho que eu sou funcionário, sou pago para isso, vou chegar lá dentro e mostrar o meu melhor sempre.
Anderson Silva is Anderson Silva, and Jose Aldo is Jose Aldo, but all I can do is train hard and do my job, which is go in there and win fights.
Dana, Mike Columbus with TXMMA.com. There's been a lot of speculation recently about what's next for the UFC, TV deals and whatnot. Without getting into speculation or confirmations or anything, how do you think the UFC fits in a broadcast sports landscape that includes football, racing, Major League Baseball, and everything else?
Yeah, I think it would be great. Now, I'm sure you're talking about the SBJ article that came out today. You know, people have been asking me to comment on that. I didn't comment when the Wall Street Journal said we bought G4 either, you know. So when you're in these negotiations, you know, all rumors start flying and everything else. But to answer your question, I think it's time. I think we do fit in to the sports world with the NFL, Major League Baseball, NBA, etc. And I've always said that what would take it to the next level would be a broadcast deal, being on one of the major networks. But to do that, you have to have the right deal. There's been other organizations out there that have popped up and jumped on the first network deal they could get. But if the deal doesn't make sense, you're going to go out of business real quick. So we've been very smart, and we've taken our time and built this thing slowly, just like you do any other business, no matter what carrots were dangling out in front of us. We know we're in this thing for the long haul, not in this thing to make money and all this. We're in this for the long haul. We got into this because we love this sport, we're passionate about it, and what we want to do is build a sport. And to me, building a sport is where everybody all over the world plays by the same rules. And that's our goal, that's what we're working on, and when the right deal comes, we'll take it.
Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
My question is for you, Dan, as well. It seems like anytime the spotlight is on Texas, as far as mixed martial arts is concerned, there seems to be some kind of snafu with the TDLR, whether it be judging, refereeing, the oxygen incident at Strikeforce Houston. How closely do you work with TDLR to put on an event like this, and how concerned are you going into an event like this that something's going to happen?
Is it just Texas? I mean, we've had some problems everywhere. You know, the thing you have to understand is first of all, this MMA is still a work in progress with the judging, the referees, and everything else. We're doing the best we can to help educate these athletic commissions, and you know, it's going to take time. It's going to take time. Look how long boxing's been around. Did you just see the Showtime fight the other day? Anybody see that? Wow. Right? I mean, boxing's been around forever. It's going to happen. It's unfortunate. I'm probably the most outspoken promoter on earth about this happening, because the thing that really drives me crazy when the commissions don't nail it 100% is it affects these guys. You know how much time and money and energy and how much of their life they put into a fight where one guy that has no clue what he's doing, who has no business refereeing or judging a fight, just sitting over there writing shit down or makes the wrong call, whatever his deal is, it affects people's lives. That's what drives me crazy. And the thing that I've said lately too, the best commission that I've dealt with has been Pennsylvania. Because the thing about Pennsylvania is when they make a mistake, they'll admit that they made a mistake, they review it, and then they overturn decisions. Nobody expects referees or judges to not be human. We're going to make mistakes, it's going to happen. At least admit that you made the mistake and go in and correct it. So I'm not scared of Texas or the commission here. You know, things happen everywhere we go, and hopefully everything will go smooth while we're here.
I know, with the UFC being the top show in the world, you know, with smaller shows like, for example, Strikeforce, they always, you know, will include local fighters on undercards. Can we expect anything like that from the UFC in the future, or at all incorporating the local guys?
Well, every time you go to a place, you know, whether it's Brazil and the Brazilians all want to fight, you know, in their home country, we go to Boston and Kenny wants to fight in Boston because it's our first show there. I mean, everywhere you go, you're going to have hometown guys that want to fight in their hometown. So we try to accommodate as many people as we can without having a whole card stacked full of guys from Houston. You know what I mean?
UFC versus Texas, yeah.
Hey, this question's for Frankie. Frankie, I'm right here for Texas, but I'm originally from Jersey, South Brunswick. Wanted to see how big of a deal would it be for you and your fans to bring that title back to Jersey one more time?
Oh, it's everything. You know, I got such great support at home, and for me to bring that title home, it's, you know, it's not only for me, it's for them too. So, you know, I feel like they're in the cage with me.
Anybody? We good? Fans? Yeah, let's get a couple fan questions. Yeah.
Mr. White, my son would like to say hi to you.
Hey, bud, what's up? How are you? Yeah, he's like the media today.
I'd like to say thank you. My family watch your Facebook news every month.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank you for editing out a couple of weeks ago that that little mishap with that gentleman in the small shorts. My son loves watching, so I appreciate that.
Yeah, I want to apologize to the whole world for that.
I was wondering if my son and I and my wife could get tickets to your event this
year. Oh, here we go.
We'd like to keep it as a family, and if one of us can't go,
tickets haven't even gone on sale yet. It's Friday.
Yes, sir.
I'll be back in Houston, and I'll be tweeting. And you guys know I always hold tickets for the fans, and I'll be tweeting tickets. So if you're not on Twitter, get on Twitter. I like that.
Hey, what's up, Dana?
How you doing?
Big fan, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hey, man. My birthday's Friday, man. What's up with some tickets?
You guys have any questions?
Okay. When's the next time you're coming back to Houston?
We didn't even come to Houston yet. How am I going to tell you when we're coming back? I will be tweeting tickets. Does anybody have any serious questions out there? All right. Yeah.
I got a quick question for Kenny. Do you think the All Balls bra will go mainstream?
Yeah, that was a video we did. It was pretty funny, but who knows? You know, maybe if someone's looking for something a little more extreme, you know, you never know. The ABB for, you know, I did a funny video for collegehumor.com, and it was basically, the only legal strike you could do was a strike to the midsection there, to the groin. So it's all groin shots. It's a video that we did that's pretty popular.
It's like a Showtime fight the other night. Yes, it already has gone mainstream. Hey, anybody else with a serious question? We'll take one more.
Hey, over here. Okay, first I'd like to say I'm a fan. Anybody else?
Thank you.
Oh, yeah? And this question is for Jose Aldo over there. What is your leg workout? Because I really like to kick like you.
É minha escola. Minha escola já vem disso desde o tempo do Ruas, né? Então eu venho dessa escola, sempre mil chutes por dia, então foi assim.
He learned that from Pedro Rizzo, watching Pedro Rizzo train and fight for many years and being able to train under him too.
Cool. All right. Thank you guys very much. What I'm going to do is we'll rip this podium out of here, and I'll square these guys off the photo op. Thank you very much, Houston. We'll see you soon.